Hey guys, welcome back. This is the continuation of Mary Parker Follett session, and this is the part 2 of it. If you have not watched the part 1, link would be in the description. Please go and watch that. So we'll continuing with what Mary Parker Follett said about power, authority and control. So about power, what she said was, Follett defines power as the ability to make things happen, to be a causal agent and to initiate change. Power is the capacity to produce intended effects. So if you have the ability to produce change, if you have the capability to make change, as you can see, capacity to produce intended effects. Agar aap mein change lane ki kshamta hai, to aapke paas power hai. This is what Mary Parker Follett says about power. If you have the ability to make things happen, only then you have the power. This is how she defines power as. And she says that power is an instinctive urge inherent in everyone. Everyone has that urge. Andar ek hota hai ke mujhe power chahiye, mujhe power chahiye. So everyone has that instinctive urge inherent in themselves. This is the power as defined by Mary Parker Follett. She makes a distinction between power over and power with. Power over, she says, that may tend to be coercive power. You are making someone do something forcefully. That is something which is power over. Zabardasti aap kuch kaam kara rahe ho kisi se. It is a coercive power. Power over is a coercive power. And power with is a jointly developed coactive power. Kisi se khushi khushi kaam karwana is power with. You are the manager, but if you are making someone do something forcefully, you are actually exercising power over him. And if you are making someone do something happily and according to his wishes, that is, you are exercising power with him. I hope you remember in previous session we had learned about that nobody wants to be subordinate to anyone, right? Everyone wants to work with someone and not under someone. So this is the same thing. As a manager, you should not exercise power over someone, you should exercise power with someone. I hope power over and power with is clear now. Power with is superior to power over, as it is a self-developing entity. Kisi se zabardasti kaam karane se hamesha acha hota hai, usse khushi khushi kaam karwao, right? So power with is always superior to power over because it is a self-developing entity. Is tarah ki power ko aapko develop karna nahi padta. It is a self-developing entity. People themselves acknowledge your power because you are not exercising it over them, you are exercising it with them, you are treating them with respect. So it is a self-developing entity. People themselves recognize your power, and that is why power with is superior to power over. And that is why you should not be coercive, you should not be forceful, you should treat everyone as equal, and you should exercise power with everyone and not power over everyone. And power with, she says that power with promotes better understanding, reduces friction and conflict, and encourages cooperative endeavor. So all these are advantages of exercising power with someone, right? Conflicts kam ho jayenge, friction kam ho jayenge, cooperation badhega, it encourages cooperative endeavor, it encourages better understanding. So all these are advantages of power with. However, Follett does not think that it is possible to get rid of power over, but thinks that one should try to reduce it. Now, having distinguished between power over and power with, she realizes this, she is aware of this thing, that it is not possible, it is impossible to get rid of power over. Power over will always be there. It is impossible to get rid of it, but as long as possible, one should try to reduce it. As long as possible, you should try to exercise power with. This can be accomplished by integrating the desires. We have seen in our previous session about integration of desires, right? So power with can be accomplished by integration of desires, obeying the law of situations. We have learned about law of situation also in our previous slide, and through functional unity. What functional unity is? Each has its functions and he should have the authority and responsibility which go with that function. Now understand something, in an organization we have division of work, right? So everyone has a function assigned to him. So whatever functions are assigned to everyone, according to those functions, they should have the matching authority and responsibility. This is functional unity. And we have seen this all over our module 2 also, that if you have been given some responsibility, you should also be given matching authority to execute that responsibility, right? So it is the same thing. Functional unity is an extension of that principle. It says that each has his own functions in an organization according to division of work and division of labor. So everyone has their own functions, and according to those functions only, they should have the authority and responsibility which go with that function. And this is nothing but functional unity as given by Mary Parker Follett. So these are the two things that she says, that power with can be accomplished by integration of desires, obeying the law of situations, and through functional unity. Follett also believes that power can never be delegated or handed out or wrenched from someone, as it is the result of knowledge and ability. But she feels that we can create conditions for the development of power. So as we have seen in the definition, she says that power is the ability to make things happen. If you have the capability to change things, to bring change, then you have the power, right? So this ability and capability cannot be delegated. You cannot just give it to someone and say that you have the power now, because it is the ability in that person to bring about the change. Even if you make someone the head of an organization, it does not necessarily ensure that he has the capability of handling power. I hope you understand this, that Follett believes power can never be delegated. This is what Follett says, that delegation of power is not possible. Power cannot be delegated, or it cannot be handed out to someone, or it cannot be wrenched from someone, as it is the result of knowledge. It is the knowledge that you have, it is the capability and ability that you have that gives you the power, and not someone or somebody that gives you the power. But she feels that we can create the conditions for development of power. We can create the conditions. How? We can increase your knowledge, we can increase your capability and ability. So that is how we can increase your power, we can increase your ability to handle that power. So we can create such conditions, we can create such environments for the development of power within you, but we cannot just delegate it to you, we cannot just give it out to you, hand it out to you. Power can never be delegated. This is what Mary Parker Follett says. Now about authority and responsibility, we'll see what she says. Follett defines authority as vested power. We have seen what power is. It is the ability to do things, right? And authority is, it is the vested power. It is the right to develop and exercise power. And this right is given to you by a certain position that you are in, by a certain function that you are performing. That gives you the right to develop the power. This will become more clear over the future points. We'll see that authority offends human dignity in terms of status and the subordination of one to another, and may cause undesirable reactions and friction. Therefore, it cannot be the basis of organization. Now, over the previous sessions, all over the module 2, we have seen what different bases of organizations are given by different thinkers. One of the most common bases of organization is function, right? Everyone says that division of work in an organization should be according to functions. In a very similar vein, Mary Parker Follett also says that authority should not be the basis of organization. In future points, we will see that she believes function should be the basis of organization, and she says that authority should not be the basis of organization because authority offends human dignity. Authority is actually making you superior over someone. You have the authority over someone, right? So authority actually offends human dignity, and that is why it should not be the basis of organization. Organization should not be divided, and department should not be created on the basis of authorities, because it offends human dignity in terms of both status and subordination of one to another, and it may cause undesirable reactions and frictions if you make it the basis of organization. Function is the true basis from which authority is derived. Now understand something, I'll repeat this, that in an organization there is division of work, and according to this division of work, everyone has some functions assigned to them individually. So whatever your functions are, only from that you derive your authority. For example, if your function is to be an assistant director, you cannot have the authority of a director. You will have the authority of the assistant director only, because that is the function you are performing, that is the role you are performing. So according to your role and according to your functions in an organization, you will have the authority. Your authority will derive from the function that you are performing. I hope this is clear now. Function is the true basis from which the authority is derived, because authority stems from the task being performed and the situation. The task you are performing and the situation you are in, the role and the function that you are in, that gives the authority to you. That is how your authority is derived. And I hope this definition is also clear to you now. Because of the function that you are performing, because of the role that you are in, that function and that role give you the right to develop the power, and this is nothing but vested power, and this is the definition of authority. So therefore she says that central authority, that is the derivation of authority from CEO, should be replaced by authority of function, in which individual has final authority within the allotted functions. So there should not be over centralization. Basic meaning of this is there should not be centralization. Basically you should aim for decentralization, and there should be authority of function. If everyone has the final authority according to their allotted functions, it will be a successful organization. This is what Mary Parker Follett believes in. There should not be a central authority, there should not be an authority which is deriving from a central CEO or someone, and it should be replaced by authority of function. authority can be conferred on others, and such conferment is not delegation. About power, we learned that power cannot be delegated, right? Mary Parker Follett says that authority can be given to others. You can give authority to others, you can confer authority on others, but such conferment is again not delegation. But still, you can confer, okay? You can confer authority on others, you can give authority on others, but power is strictly no delegation. No delegation in case of power, but authority can be conferred. Follett believes that delegation of authority should be an obsolete expression. Now remember this, she says that should be an obsolete expression because even she knows that it is not possible. She says that it should be. We should try to make delegation of authority an obsolete expression because it does not actually exist. She says that we can confer authority and not delegate it. So delegation of authority should be an obsolete expression. And if we see today, it has still not become an obsolete expression. We still use the term delegation of authority. We still say that you can delegate authority and responsibility to your subordinates, right? So delegation of authority has still not become an obsolete expression, but Follett says that delegation of authority should become in future. We should try to make delegation of authority, this term, as an obsolete expression, because authority can be conferred but not delegated. Like authority, responsibility also flows from this function and the situation. So we have seen how function is the true basis of authority, right? Function and the situation that you are in. Similar way, responsibility also flows from the function and the situation. This is what Mary Parker Follett says. Therefore, one should ask, for what is he responsible? Then to whom is he responsible? To give you an example for this, let's say you are an administrator, an IPS or an IAS officer. So as an IPS or an IAS officer, the question that you should be asking is, to whom are you responsible? You are responsible to the citizens, right? So that is the main question that you should be asking, to whom are you responsible, instead of asking for what are you responsible. That is your job. For what are you responsible is your job. You should not be asking for what are you responsible. You have to do it anyway. That is your job to do. But when you ask the question of who are you responsible to, that gives you proper responsibility in yourself. That gives you proper sense of authority that you have. So the proper question that you should be asking is, to whom are you responsible, instead of to what are you responsible. And this is what she says from the lines that responsibility also flows from the function and situation, just like authority. Follett also believes in pluralistic concept of responsibility or cumulative responsibility, and rejects the ultimate responsibility as an illusion. Now understand this term, pluralistic responsibility. Let me give you an example. Let's say there are 5 people in a team and they are working on one project, and let's say that project has 5 components and those components are given to 5 of each people, right? So there are 5 people in a team working on a project and each one has their own component of that project. So what pluralistic responsibility means is, everyone should know each other's work. It should not happen that only one person is responsible for that one component. This is how project is doomed. It should not happen like this. There should be a pluralistic responsibility. Everyone should be responsible for the whole project. Even the manager of the project should be responsible. And she rejects the idea of ultimate responsibility as an illusion. So one person should not have the ultimate responsibility. Everyone should have the responsibility for that project, because everyone is working on that project, right? The 5 people in a team and the manager of the project, everyone should have pluralistic responsibility. If the project goes down, everyone should be held responsible. So this is what Follett believes, that there is no concept of ultimate responsibility but plural responsibility. Now make note of these things and remember these terms. These are like important terms, pluralistic responsibility. UPSC might surprise you by including these terms in question, and if you are seeing these terms for the first time in question, you might get confused. But always remember ke jo dikhta hai utna difficult nahi hota hai. It's very simple. These terms are actually what they look like, and they are very simple. If you understand the crux behind the question, if you understand the basic idea behind the question, if you know what the question demands of you, you can very well write the answer, and that can obviously come by practice. So remember these terms, pluralistic responsibility. You never know if you see this term in the exam next time, right? So Follett believes in pluralistic responsibility or cumulative responsibility and not in ultimate responsibility. So moving on, control. About control, she says that like authority and responsibility, control is also an important aspect to achieve organizational goals. There should be control in an organization. Without control, there can never be an organization. There can never be an achievement of organizational goals. So you talk about power with instead of power over, and you talk about treating everyone equally and treating everyone with respect, and you talk about all these things, but still control should be there in an organization. As opposed to classical thinkers, Follett believes in fact control and not man control. We have seen that all of the classical thinkers believed in man control. They believed in the economic man concept. They said that every man is motivated by money, so they tried to control every person like that. But Follett believes in fact control. There should be control based on facts and situations and truths. Not just because you are a manager you have to control, you should control based on some facts and relevant situations. And she also believes in correlated control and not superimposed control. This is same as power over and power with. She believes in correlated control. Everyone should be coordinated while exercising your power. This is nothing but correlated control and not superimposed control. Since facts vary from situation to situation, control should depend upon the facts of each situation instead of superiors controlling subordinates. So situations are dynamic, so instead of forming a particular habit in yourself about giving orders and controlling people, how you should control is that should be dynamic on the situation, that should be inherent on the situation that you are in. So control should depend upon the facts of each situation because situation is dynamic and situations vary and facts also vary from situation to situation. Similarly, situations are far too complex for central control to be meaningfully effective. Therefore, Follett suggests that control mechanism should be correlated at many places in the organizational structure. Again, the same thing, she is against centralization of an organization. She says that there should not be centralized control. There should be correlated control at many places in the organizational structure. So there should not be a hierarchical model, a top-down model, a centralized model. There should be a correlated control model at many places in the organization. So no centralized control. She is against centralized control. She is for decentralization. A unified organization, which is well integrated in her sense, is a self-regulating and self-directing organism. In all such organizations, Follett feels control tends to be self-control. So if your organization is well integrated, that is to say if your organization is unified very beautifully, such an organization is a self-regulating and self-directing organism. You do not need to exercise direction and power and control exclusively. It will be a self-regulating and self-directing organism. Such a unified organism will be under self-control. This is what Follett believes. So this is everything that Follett says about power, authority and control. So moving on to our next topic, what Follett said about planning and coordination. So to Follett, planning is a scheme of self-adjusting and self-coordinating the various and varying interests. So in an organization, there are various people and these people will have different self-interest and different differences among themselves, right? So these different and various and varying interests of different people in an organization, when they self-adjust themselves and they self-coordinate themselves, this is nothing but planning. Planning is a scheme of self-adjusting and self-coordinating the various and varying interests in an organization. The process of self-adjusting is possible only through coordination and ye self-adjusting aise hi apne apne ho jata hai coordination ke through hoga. This is nothing but the thoughts of Follett on planning and coordination. Planning is a scheme for self-adjusting and this self-adjusting can be achieved only through coordination. To Follett, coordination implies harmonious ordering of different parts of the whole organization. So if there is a harmony among everything and everyone, this is nothing but coordination and this coordination can achieve planning. So as you can see, process of self-adjusting is possible only through coordination and this process of self-adjusting is nothing but the definition of planning that Follett gives us. To achieve coordination, she postulates four principles of organization. Now as other classical thinkers also gave us principles of organization, Follett also gives us four principles of organization, but she gives us these four principles for achieving coordination and not to achieve maximum efficiency and doing one best way or something else. She gives these four principles to achieve coordination. First principle is coordination as the reciprocal relating of all factors in a situation. We have seen this in our previous slide that a situation consists of various facts and these facts change from situation to situation, right? So all the factors in a situation should be considered and these have to be related to one another and you have to consider these interrelationships between various factors of a situation. So if you have to achieve coordination, this coordination should be the reciprocal of relating of all factors in a situation. There should be a responsive nature on your end. You should be responsive to different situations. You should be reciprocal to different situations. That is how you will achieve coordination. I hope this is clear to you. Second principle is coordination by direct contact. Responsible people in the organization must be in direct contact with one another irrespective of their position in the hierarchy. So if you are a CEO and you have a manager who is two levels below you, you must be in direct contact with him because both of you are responsible in organization. So irrespective of your position in the hierarchy of the organization, you should be in direct contact and this is how you will achieve coordination. This is the second principle to achieve coordination, by direct contact. The third principle is coordination in the early stages. All the people concerned should be involved at the stage of policy formulation simulation itself, then being involved at the implementation stage, and this will benefit the organization through increased motivation and morale. So if you are formulating a policy, if you ask opinions to your employees, if you ask opinion to your subordinates, this is what will increase their motivation. Ke haan, humse poocha ja raha hai, kuch to change kar rahe hain aur humse pooch rahe hain uske bare mein, to hum important hain, right? So this will increase their motivation if you involve them in policy formulation itself instead of implementing stage. You have formulated a policy and now you are saying that okay, this is what you should do, this is what you should do. So instead of involving them only at implementation of that policy stage, you should involve them at policy formulation also. Ki humko batao kya karna chahiye, ye acha hai kya, aisa kare kya, aise bura hai kya. So this is how you will increase their motivation. So this is nothing but coordination in early stages. The fourth principle is coordination is a continuing process. So coordination does not stop somewhere, it does not come to an end. Need for a permanent machinery to achieve coordination, it should be a permanent machinery, it is a continuous process. That is why there should be a permanent machinery in every organization to achieve coordination, from planning to activity and from activity to further planning. So for every stage coordination is a continuing process. Agar aap plan kar rahe ho, fir activity kar rahe ho, fir activity se aapko aur bhi further plan karna padega to realize your failures and your successes. So at every stage coordination is a continuous process and there should be a permanent machinery in every organization to achieve this continuous coordination. Also, information based on continuous research is important because it would act as a form of control, a tendency to act in accordance with the information given if it were accepted as accurate. So whatever coordination you are doing, it should be happening based on some well researched facts and some truthful information. This is what Follett says, that information based on continuous research is important because it would act as a form of control, because you are giving facts, you are giving truths, right? Aap information de rahe ho, facts de rahe ho, sachche truths de rahe ho aap. So this would automatically act as a form of control. You need not exercise control exclusively for that. So information based on research is important in coordination, and this is how coordination is a continuous process. And these are the four principles of organization for coordination as given by Mary Parker Follett. So moving on, we'll see more about coordination. Administration itself implies coordination, and administrator must have the ability to transmute individual rivalries into collective gain. This is creative conflict in Follett's words. So this is again a new word, creative conflict, but it does not mean anything. It simply means that you should be a good administrator and you should be a good coordinator. As you can see, administration itself implies coordination, and this is quite obvious, right? As an administrator, as an IAS officer or as an IEPS officer, you should be a good coordinator. This is what the job demands of you. If you are not a good coordinator, then you are not a good administrator. Administering is coordinating, right? So administration itself implies coordination, and an administrator, as an IAS or IPS officer, you must have the ability to transmute or to change your individual rivalries into collective gain, which has the advantage for the whole society, the collective gain. Such rivalries should be transformed or transmuted or changed into collective gain. This is the ability that you should have, and this is nothing but creative conflict. This is what Follett means by creative conflict. Administration itself implies coordination. Follett regards lack of coordination as the chief weakness in business organization, which is attributed to its hierarchical structure. So because every business organization is hierarchical in structure, there is a centralized control, a top-down model that is in existence in every business organization, there is a lack of coordination. And because of this lack of coordination, those organizations are weak. And this is the chief weakness that Follett says, lack of coordination. See, instead supports horizontal authority involving cross-functioning in the place of present-day vertical authority. Now what is cross-functioning? Now try to relate this with the concept of pluralistic responsibility. It is actually very much related to each other. Follett has used these terms in the same sentence. We are using it in different contexts, in under coordination and under responsibility, but when Follett used it in her book, she used it actually in the same sentence. So connect this with pluralistic responsibility. Cross-functioning is, if there are a group of five people and everyone is working on a project and everyone has a component of their own, so these five people should be knowing what each of the other four components are also. So there should be a horizontal authority instead of vertical authority. Vertical authority is only the manager knows everything, and that is why he has the main authority above all of the group members, right? So that is the vertical authority. But instead she suggests horizontal authority, that is everyone should know what is happening in the project, and not the only manager. Everyone should know what is happening, and there should be cross-functioning. This is what is horizontal authority. It is related to the concept of pluralistic responsibility. So try to connect these things, cross-functioning, pluralistic responsibility, and try to remember these terms. These are important terms. If you encounter them in exam, do not take tension. These are very simple terms: creative conflict, pluralistic responsibility, cross-functioning. The chief reason for lack of coordination, however, is that we have not grasped the true nature of coordination. It must be fully recognized that coordination is not a culminating process but a continuous process. We have seen this right in our previous slide, that coordination is a continuous process, it is not a culminating process. So we have not grasped the true nature of coordination, and that is why there is lack of coordination. This is what Mary Parker Follett says. Now pay attention to this point, this is a very important point. Coordinated control, this is a new term that Follett gives us, coordinated control. Now coordinated control is more than a mere addition of specific controls. Field of control is determined not only by its constituents but by the relations with one another. This means that if one factor is withdrawn or added to a situation, then what you have is not just simply that situation minus or plus that factor, because all the rest will be changed. So let's say you have a situation, and that situation will be dependent on various factors, right? So let's say you remove one of those factors from that situation, you have withdrawn one of those factors from that situation. So aisa nahi hai ki aapke paas ab jo bacha wo bas situation minus that factor hai, aisa nahi hai, because everything has changed. A situation and its factors are all related to one another. All the factors in a situation depend on each other. So if you remove one of those factors, it is not just simply minus that factor. As you can see, what you have now is not just simply that situation minus or plus that factor. It is not that simple, because everything else depends on that factor also, because all the rest will be changed if you withdraw one of the factors. And she gives us an example for that. In a board of directors, let's say one man leaves, there is a board of directors of say let's say 10 people, and one man leaves and all the rest become a little different. The influence of that board of directors as a total is not the same as it was minus that man's influences, because his withdrawal by changing slightly every other man has made the total a little different. So let's say there are 10 people in a board of directors, and one person from that board of directors leaves. So whatever 9 people are remaining, those will not be equal to 10 minus 1, because that one person had an effect, had an influence on all of those 9 other people, right? So when that one person leaves, other people also change. They will think about that person when he has left. So to say, if you remove one factor from the situation, all of the other factors will be changed. It is not just simply that situation minus one factor. It is not that simple. And this is what she means by field of control is determined not only by its constituents but by their relations with one another. So if you have a field of control, if you have a board of directors controlling the organization, that field of control is determined not only by its constituents. Sirf 10 minus 1 or 10 plus 2 se determine nahi hota hai. It is also determined by their relations with one another, and this is nothing but coordinated control. I hope you understand coordinated control now. Coordinated control is more than a mere addition of specific controls. This is what Follett believes about coordination. So moving on, we will see what Follett said about leadership now. So about leaders, Follett says that being a head of an organization does not make you a leader, but having some specific traits or having some specific characteristics of your own make you a leader. So to Mary Parker Follett, a leader is not the president of the organization or the head of the department, but one who can see all around a situation, who sees it as related to certain purposes and policies, who sees it evolving into the next situation, who understands how to pass from one situation to another. Or what makes you a leader is the man who can energize his group, who knows how to encourage initiative, how to draw from all what each has to give, or the man who can show that the order is integral to the situation, or the man who is expression of a harmonious and effective unity which he has helped to form and which he is able to make a going concern. Very simply put, if you are a president of an organization, let's say if you are the prime minister of a nation, being the prime minister of the nation does not make you a good leader. What makes you a good leader are your characteristics. So a position does not define how good a leader you are. A leader is not made by position, a leader is made by his characteristics and his virtues. So if you can see all around a situation, as you can see, if you can see all around a situation, that's what makes him a good leader, and not the prime minister of a nation, right? And not the president of a nation, and not the chief minister of a state. So if you can see all around a situation, that is why you are a leader, who sees it as related to certain purposes and policies, who sees it evolving into the next situation. So if you can anticipate, then you are a good leader. If you can energize your whole group, if you can encourage initiative, then you are a good leader. If you can ensure harmony, then you are a good leader. If you can ensure unity, which you have helped to form, then you are a good leader. So these are the characteristics or traits of a good leader that Mary Parker Follett says. She believes that a leader is not the president of the organization or the head of the department. Such people, Follett feels, are found not just at the apex but throughout the organization. Such good leaders with such virtues and such characteristics are found throughout the organization and not just at the top. The CEO is not the only leader. The manager is not the only leader, but leaders are found throughout the organization. Anyone who possesses any of these virtues is a good leader. According to Follett, coordination, definition of purpose, and anticipation, these are the three functions of the leader. So if you are able to anticipate things, if you are able to define the purpose of your team or your organization, and if you are able to coordinate, then you are a good leader. These are the three functions of the leader: coordination, definition of purpose, and anticipation. Follett stresses that leaders are not only born but also can be made through education and training in organization and department. Now, when you will study module 3, administrative behavior, in that you will study various theories of leadership. So one of the most prevalent theories of leadership in traditional era was that leaders are born, they are not made, leaders are born. But Follett challenged this idea. She challenged that idea that leaders are born. She says that leaders are not only born but also they can be made. If you give them proper training, if you give them proper education, if you develop these virtues, these qualities, these characteristics in a person, you can make them a good leader. This is what Follett believes in, that leaders are not only born but they also can be made through education and training. Follett distinguishes between three different types of leadership. The first leadership is leadership of position. Leader holds a position of formal authority. So you are a leader because of your position. This is the first kind of leadership, leadership of position. Leadership of personality. One becomes a leader because of his forceful personality. Because you have such personality that you can force others to follow you. You can force others to be your subordinate. That is why you are a leader. This is the second type of leadership, leadership of personality. And one who holds both position and personality can lead with much more ease. So you can lead much more easily if you hold both leadership of position and leadership of personality. The third type of leadership that Follett says is the leadership of function. In modern organizations, leaders exercise leadership because others are influenced by their judgments. One possessing the knowledge demanded by a certain situation becomes the leader. Very simply, the functions that you are performing, the knowledge that you have, the ability that you have, the capability to bring about a change that you have, this is what makes you a leader, and this is what the leadership of function means. To give you again the example of Prime Minister of India, Mr. Narendra Modi is not the leader of the country because he is appointed as Prime Minister, but because he has those certain qualities, he has those certain characteristics, he has those certain traits that make him a good leader. That is why Narendra Modi is a good leader. Not because he is a Prime Minister, he is a leader. You can be a Prime Minister and you can be a bad leader. You can be a Chief Minister or you can be a head of the department and you can be a bad leader. So leadership of function derives from your functions that you are performing, the knowledge that you possess, demanded by a certain situation that you are in. That is how you become a leader. This is nothing but leadership of function, and this is what Follett believes in modern organizations. Leadership of function is very prevalent. So there are the three types of leaderships: leadership of position, leadership of personality, and leadership of function. So leadership of function, will deal with leadership of function a little more. Leadership goes to the man with the knowledge of the situation, who understands its total significance and who can see it through. So we can see this recurring theme all over our session of Mary Parker Follett, that she believes in the situation. We have learnt about the law of the situation in our previous session. We have seen how authority also derives from the situation, how power derives from the situation, how responsibility derives from the situation, how control also derives from the situation, and now leadership also derives from the situation. She says that leadership goes to the man who has the knowledge of the situation, who understands its total significance, and who can see it through. Leadership of function is inherent in the job. This is what I said, right? It is inherent in the job. It is what the job you are performing, it is the function that you are performing that is making you a leader. And not because that you are in a certain position that is making you a leader, but it is inherent in the job that you are doing. So leadership of function is inherent in the job, and experts can give orders even to those of higher rank. So aap apne upar wale manager ko bhi aap order de sakte ho if you are an expert. This is what you mean by leadership of function is inherent in the job, and this is why leaders are found throughout the organization. If you are an expert, if you have the ability and capability, you are a leader. She gives an example, like the dispatch clerk can give orders to the superintendent, and the stores clerk can tell the man in charge of purchasing when to act. So man in charge of purchasing just knows how to purchase, right? But a store clerk actually knows when there is a demand to purchase, when he should actually purchase. So a store clerk can tell man in charge of purchasing when to act. So he is actually lower than man in charge of purchasing, but still he can order his superior to purchase. This is what leadership of function is. It is inherent in the job that you are doing. Experts can give orders even to those of the higher rank. Though personality plays a large part in leadership, Follett believes that leadership of function is becoming more important than leadership of personality. Obviously, personality plays a large part in leadership. We are seeing this in every walk of our life, right? If you have a good personality, that is when you are a good leader. So personality plays a large part in leadership. What is leadership of personality? If you can force others to be your followers, if you can force others to be your subordinate, then you have a leadership of personality. So personality obviously plays a large part in leadership, because to create followers, you need to force something through them, right? So personality plays a large part, but Follett believes that leadership of function is becoming more important than leadership of personality. Follett also believes that the success of any organization depends on its being sufficiently flexible to allow the leadership of function to operate fully, to allow the men with the knowledge and technique to control the situation. So if you want your organization to succeed, you should have leadership of function. Very simply, this means that you should allow the men with knowledge and the technique to control the situation. That is nothing but you should have leadership of function in your organization if you want your organization to succeed. This is what Mary Parker Follett says about leadership of function. Thus, Follett has called attention to the emergence of leadership by functions long before the term situational approach came into use. So as I have already told you, the term situation we have seen all over Mary Parker Follett session, right? We have seen the law of the situation, how authority, power, responsibility, control, everything is defined by situation, how leadership of function is also defined by situation, the man who has the knowledge of situation, right? So long before the term situational approach came into use, Mary Parker Follett used the term situation, and she gave us the leadership by functions long before the term situational approach came into use. This is to her credit that she identified something which was long before in vogue. Also, she identified humanistic principles in organization, if you remember. So she was very ahead of her times. She was very, very ahead of her times. So if you get this question in examination, let's say in UPSC, that Mary Parker Follett was ahead of this of her times, you should use these terms. Like, long before the term situational approach came into use, she gave us leadership by functions, and she was a bridge between classical theory and human relations approach and whatnot. So moving on, we'll move on criticisms and defense of Mary Parker Follett now. So to look at some of the criticisms, she was criticized for ignoring the social nature of processes involved in the management of organization. She threw all the real social class conflicts off the scale and considered only psychological conflicts arising mainly from lack of understanding, misapprehensions and differences in personal qualities. So basically, we have seen that while dealing with conflicts, Mary Parker Follett said that conflicts happen due to misunderstanding. If you do not decode the language properly, if you do not decode the symbols properly, if you remember, right? So these are all psychological aspects only of a conflict. What actually happens also in an organization are class conflicts, jat pat ki bhi conflicts hoti hai, because society as a whole plays a part in everything. So there are class conflicts also, there are social conflicts also in an organization, and Mary Parker Follett ignored everything, all of those social and class conflicts, and she threw all of these off the scale, and she just focused on lack of understanding and misapprehensions and differences of opinion, and she talked about integration of different desires and everything, but she did not talk about social and class differences. This is what is the first criticism. She is criticized for ignoring the social nature of the processes involved in the management of organizations. Second is, her ideas on integration are criticized as being illusory. So whatever she has said, it is just an illusion. It cannot be achieved. Badi badi baatein kar di hain sirf, usko achieve to kar nahi sakte. So it is just illusory. Her ideas on integration are just illusory. It is very difficult to achieve integration in real life. It is just an illusion. This is the second criticism. D. Vishyani, he is a Russian thinker. So D. Vishyani criticized her for empirical and non-scientific nature of her writings. Now what do you mean by empirical? Something that is based on experience and experiments. Now those experiments may be scientific and may not be scientific, and what Follett's theory is, it is based on experiments but it is not scientific in nature. It is empirical but it is not scientific in nature. So this is what D. Vishyani criticized her for, empirical and non-scientific nature of her writings. She is criticized for being a non-systematic writer. She threw out interesting ideas more or less randomly, and therefore the thread of consistency was hard to find and harder to follow. Not all her readers would see where her thoughts would lead them. So basically, she gave us very interesting ideas, some very beautiful ideas. बहुत ही अच्छी अच्छी बातें बोली हैं, लेकिन randomly बोली हैं. There is no coherency, right? They are not coherent. ऐसा नहीं है कि एक particular flow है. There is no particular flow to her ideas. These are just random ideas. Coordination के ऊपर बोल दिया, leadership के ऊपर बोल दिया, control के ऊपर बोल दिया, conflict के ऊपर बोल दिया. Just randomly she has spoken about everything. There is no coherency. There is no particular flow to her ideas. So she is a non-systematic writer. This is the other criticism, that she threw out interesting ideas, but she threw out more or less randomly, and they are very hard to follow. other criticism is, therefore it was observed that her valuable ideas and useful recommendations, her ideas and recommendations are very valuable and useful, but they do not conform to a theoretically well-founded and integrated system because they are random, because they are non-scientific, because they are illusory, and that is why they do not conform to a theoretically well-founded and integrated system. These are the criticisms of Mary Parker Foley. Now we'll defend her. So in her defense, she did not make any distinction between public and private administration. Her prescriptions apply equally to private businesses as to public administration, even though her lectures were delivered to private industry. So whatever her lectures were, whatever her theories and writings were, they were all meant for private industries. But as we can see, we can relate them to public administration also. As I have already given you examples, what you would do if you were an IAS or IPS officers, right? So her ideas did not make any distinction between public and private administration, even though they were meant for private industry. This we can say in her defense. Her ideas are universal, so to say. Foley believed in balance in a mix. She avoided either or solutions and preferred both or end. So what are either or solutions? Ya to aap ye kar lo, ya to aap wo kar lo. Aisa bhi kar sakte ho, waisa bhi kar sakte ho. So she avoided such situations of either or. She gave us perfect situations. Either you both of these things, or you do not do any of these things, or you do this and you do this. She did not say you do this or you do this. She said you do this and you do this, right? So she avoided either or solutions and she preferred both and end. So she believed in a balance and she believed in a mix. The either or approach to public administration is too simplistic, she says, and it overlooks the central fact that human society itself is pluralistic and solutions to problems too must take into account the right claims of all the sides. So itna simplistic solution nahi hota hai real life mein. It's not so simple. Either or is very simplistic, she says. Either or approach is very simplistic and real life is not so simple. Either or approach is also too authoritarian. If you do not want to be an authoritarian, if you want to be a democrat, then you should avoid either or approach. This is what Foley believes in. She is regarded as a bridge between the classical approach and behavioral human relations approach. Now we have discussed this so many times, we'll see it once more, that she is regarded as the bridge between classical approach and human relations approach. Unlike other contemporary theories, she viewed organization as a social system and administration as a social process. So everything was connected to society as a whole. Society influences everything. This is what she believed in. So organization was a social system and administration was a social process for her. She highlighted for the first time the sociological and psychological dimensions of administration and management. And this, remember that this was not done by any classical thinker. You take F.W. Taylor, you take Henry Fayol or Gulick and Arvik or anyone. This was not done by any classical thinker. It was only she that she viewed organization as a social system. She gave sociological dimension of organization. She viewed administration as a social process. She gave psychological dimensions of administration and management. It was only to her credit. And that is why she is a bridge between classical approach and behavioral humanist approach. She brought out the human dimensions of organization. We have already seen this. She pointed out the role of situational factors on organizational behavior. We have already seen this too, right? Long before the term situational approach became popular, she gave us the term leadership by functions. So she pointed out the role of situational factors also. She gave us the law of the situation, if you remember from our previous session. Hence, Foley is looked at the precursor or the forerunner of the behavioral human relations approach. Daniel Rand says, chronologically, she belonged to the scientific management era and philosophically to the social man era. So philosophically, she was a person of social man era, but historically, if you see, chronologically, if you see, she belonged to the scientific management era of F.W. Taylor. As a classical thinker, she believed in the universality of her principles of organizations. We have seen this, right? She did not distinguish between private and public administration. Her principles of organization were universal. She also gave us four principles of organization, if you remember, for achieving coordination. So as a classical thinker, because she lived in an era of classical theory, as a classical thinker, she believed in the universality of her principles of organization. And as a behavioralist human relationist, she emphasized the significance of socio-psychological aspects of organizational behavior. We have seen this too, right? So she believed in principles also, she believed in universality of her principles also, and she believed in human side of the organization also, society also, and that is why she is the bridge between classical approach and human relations approach. Arvik and Metcalf observed, her conceptions were in advance of her time. They are still in advance of current thinking. And we have discussed this, that she was way too ahead of her times. Long before the term situational approach became the norm, she gave us leadership by function. So she was actually way ahead of her time, and she is actually still in advance of current thinking. This is what Irwick and Metcalf observed. Her conceptions were in advance of her time. She was way ahead of her time. But they are a goldmine of suggestions for anyone who is interested in the problems of establishing and maintaining human cooperation in the conduct of an enterprise. Even though she is well ahead of her time, still her suggestions are goldmine for current times. This is what Irwick and Metcalf observed, and this is how Follett was a bridge between classical approach and human relations approach. I hope this is clear to you now. So in her defense, we'll continue. To Follett, administration essentially involved reconciliation involving individuals as well as social groups. We have seen this, that in her book The New State, she gave us an alternative system of governance, right, which involved voluntary groups, the neighborhood voluntary groups. So basically Follett believed in reconciliation, and this reconciliation was involving everyone, the individual as well as social groups. So this is in her defense that we can say this. Taylor and many other classical thinkers thought of management as a series of separate functions, where one function is the most important than all the others. Follett departed from this line of thinking. If you remember, every of the thinkers that we have studied, F.W. Taylor gave us some principles of scientific management, and he believed that there is one best way of doing any work, and he believed that this is the most important function of finding one best way. If you consider Henry Fayol, he believed, or if you consider any of the classical thinker, all of them believed that division of work was the most important principle. They gave us a list of principles. Irwick even gave us 29 principles. So they gave us a list of principles, but all of them believed that division of work was most important. So if you consider Taylor and many other thinkers, they believed that one function is most important than all the others. But Follett departed from this line of thinking. She believed all of the functions are important, all of the principles are important, and all of the principles are universal. This is what we can say in her defense. She laid the foundation for understanding group dynamics, authority and cooperation, and advocated a wider participation of individuals in organization. Now understand something, that this is something very common nowadays. You understand authority and cooperation nowadays, but back in her time, she was the person who laid the foundation for these things, for understanding group dynamics, for understanding authority and cooperation, and wider participation of individuals in organization. She was the person who initiated these things. Follett died in 1933. Elton Mayo in 1933 started his decade-long most famous management studies, which are nothing but Hawthorne experiments. Follett thus anticipated the human relations movement in administration, and this is why she is the bridge between classical and human relations approach. Elton Mayo belongs to the human relations era. When we study human relations, you will realize Elton Mayo is one of those persons. Follett's views constituted a new approach to management. She was critical of the classical theory of organization for its one-sidedness, its machine-like concept of man, the economic man concept. She was critical of this. She said that there are human side to organization also, and we should not neglect these human sides. We should not neglect the society, the psychological factors of every organization. So she was critical of classical theory in this aspect, and this is how she constituted a new approach to management. Her observations are consistent with the views of contemporary writers also, contemporary writers like Chris Argyris, Douglas McGregor, Renesis Likert, Bennis, and so on. So all of these contemporary writers are writing something or have written something which are consistent with views that Follett gave back in the era of classical theory. Remember that she was way ahead of her time. She discussed themes like integration between the individual and the organization, the joint partnership between the management and employees, sharing of power, authority by consent, democratic decision making, and the law of the situation. All of these things she said long before they became a norm, long before they became common for use. So her observations back then are still consistent with the writings of contemporary writers. So we are done with Mary Parker Follett. So as always, I will always request you to please practice the questions, because it is just the initial inhibition or the initial hesitation that you have to overcome. And once you write the questions, you will realize where you lack. And even if you are not able to write the complete answer, even if you are able to write just one or two lines, do write that, because it is good to make mistakes and errors now than to make mistakes in exam, right? So practice them and get consistency in your writing. Anyway, prelims are near, so you must focus on prelims also. Majority of your focus should be on prelims now. These are the times of clearing prelims. So we'll discuss some UPSC questions. Follett's work was not directed towards the resolution of conflict of ideas, but towards the resolution of structural conflicts between workers and capitalists. In the light of the statement, critically evaluate Follett's ideas of dynamic administration. So this is a question for 20 marks, and this is a very weird question. It says that Follett did not target resolution of conflict of ideas. She targeted conflicts, resolution of structural conflicts between workers and capitalists, between workers and management, that is to say. So whatever structural conflicts were there, that is what she targeted, and not the conflict of ideas. So what this basically means is she tried to undo the centralization. She tried more on decentralization. If you remember, pluralistic responsibility, cross-functioning, horizontal authority, all of these things. So she did not believe in vertical authority, right? So she strived more towards resolution of structural conflicts and less towards conflict of ideas. She talked about integration and everything, and this is why you have to critically evaluate. You have to give the positive and the negative side of both. You have to critically evaluate this statement. In the light of this statement, you have to critically evaluate Follett's idea. So this is a question for 20 marks. It was asked in 2015. In 2011, they asked critically examine conflict resolution according to MP Follett. Very simple. Explain how McGregor took forward our ideas in the context of complex organization. So what Douglas McGregor said about conflict resolution and how he took forward our ideas, we'll learn about in Douglas McGregor's theory X and theory Y whenever we learn that. This is a 30 mark question. 30 mark questions are no longer asked in UPSC. This is a 2011 question. Syllabus was changed in 2012. So such 30 mark questions are no longer asked. So if you can even write 15 marks question of the first half, critically examine conflict resolution according to Mary Parker Follett. So this is the half answer that you can write. It would be good. So do practice these questions. I have included some UPSC and some non-UPSC questions also. So on this note, I would like to thank you for listening to this session. Please like, comment and share this video if you like the content. Also subscribe to the channel if you do not want to miss the next video that I upload. Hope to see you soon in my next session. Peace out.